On October 26, 2005, the corpse of a 42-year-old woman was left suspended in the public view for hours in Frederica, Delaware. Because her lifeless body was assumed to be yet another Halloween display, the unnamed woman hung herself from a tree located across a moderately busy road from some homes. Her body, suspended about 15 feet above the ground, could easily be seen from passing vehicles. The state police spokesman and neighbors said that people noticed the body around 7:30 that morning, but dismissed it as a holiday prank. Authorities arrived at the scene at about 11 to begin the process of examining the scene and removing the body. The deceased lived about a quarter mile from where the body was discovered. Similarly, in mid-October 2009, the decomposing body of a 75-year-old suicide victim sat undisturbed on the balcony of the deceased's home in Marina del Rey, California, for several days because neighbors assumed it was merely a part of a Halloween display. Mustafa Zayed had apparently been dead for 3 days, with a single gunshot wound to one eye. He was slumped over a chair on the third floor balcony of his apartment, said cameraman Austin Raishbrook, who was on the scene when authorities were alerted to the body. Neighbors told Raishbrook that they noticed the body 3 days earlier, but didn't bother calling authorities because it looked like a Halloween dummy. The body was in plain view of the entire apartment complex. They all didn't do anything, said Raishbrook. It's very strange. It did look unreal, to be honest. An investigator with the Los Angeles County Sheriff's Department said the case is an apparent suicide and declined to comment further. These grisly accounts of suicides being mistaken for Halloween props is the reverse of what we've previously seen. Deliberate attempts at presenting spooky visual effects resulting in actual accidental demises. All too often, young people have staged fake hanging scenes, and turns out something goes horribly wrong, thereby ending their lives. Cindy Song was a 21-year-old South Korean student attending Pennsylvania State University in 2001. She dressed up in a bunny costume and attended a Halloween party at a nightclub. After leaving the club, Cindy spent the next few hours hanging out with her friends before she was dropped off at her apartment about 4 o'clock in the morning. This was the last anyone ever saw of her. After Cindy was reported missing, a search was conducted of her apartment. There was no sign of any struggle, but many of her belongings, including the false eyelashes from her costume, were still there, indicating that she had gone inside after being dropped off. But what happened to her afterward? Shortly thereafter, a witness reported seeing a woman resembling Cindy in the Chinatown district of Philadelphia. This woman was inside a vehicle with an unidentified male and crying out for help. A bizarre lead came about in 2003 when a man named Hugo Marcus Selinsky was arrested after the remains of 5 people were found buried in his backyard. Even though none of these remains belonged to Cindy, an informant told police that Selinsky and his accomplice named Michael Kurkowski Jr. had abducted her. After that, Cindy was raped and murdered. The two men allegedly buried her body in another location. Kurkowski's remains were found in Selinsky's backyard, and the informant claimed Kurkowski was murdered for keeping Cindy's bunny ears as a souvenir. Thus far, no evidence was found to tie Selinsky to Cindy's disappearance. But in January 2014, the burned remains of a dozen more people were found buried on his property. It remains to be seen if any of them will be identified as Cindy Song. A 15-year-old Orthodox Jewish boy was attending high school in New York. The morning after Halloween in 1986, the entire school was horrified when he was found murdered on his dorm room floor. He had been bludgeoned to death, and after a sharp blow to the skull, he was repeatedly stabbed in the head, but no murder weapon could be found anywhere. Since there was no evidence of a struggle, it seemed likely that he was killed in bed while he slept before his body was moved to the floor. By all accounts, He was a very well-liked boy, so no one could figure out a possible motive for the crime. There were signs that the killer was familiar with his Jewish beliefs. Even though it had been a chilly night, the window of his room was open, something which is often done to let the deceased person's spirit out. After the murder, one of the school's rabbis left a memorial candle to burn in his room. 2 days later, a second candle appeared, but no one ever admitted putting it there. There were no signs of forced entry anywhere, indicating the killer may have been familiar with the dormitory. During the night, another student on his floor remembered being momentarily awakened when the door to his room was open before it was immediately shut again. Could the killer have initially entered the wrong room by mistake? After 28 years, authorities have never been able to find a suspect or any answers about why he was murdered in such a brutal fashion. In 1982, 69-year-old Marvin Brandlin lived with his wife in Fort Dodge, Iowa. On Halloween that year, the Brandlins were handing out candy to trick-or-treaters who came by their house. At one point, they answered the door and were surprised to see a man wearing a mask. He said, "Trick-or-treat, give me your money or I'll shoot." The Brandlins thought someone was playing a Halloween prank and tried to remove the man's mask, but he wouldn't let them. Instead, the masked man entered the house and pulled out a gun. He demanded that the couple bring him down to the basement and give him all the money they had stashed in their safe. The Brandlins became suspicious since very few people knew that they had a safe in their basement. For this reason, Marvin was still convinced that a friend or a family member was simply playing a Halloween trick on them. When the masked man led the Brandlins through the kitchen toward the basement, Marvin grabbed for the gun. The intruder wound up shooting Marvin in the throat before fleeing and leaving the mask behind. His wife was so traumatized by her husband's death that she died only a few months later. Over the years, an acquaintance of the Brandlin family had allegedly bragged about committing the murder, so DNA testing was performed on the mask. However, there wasn't enough usable material for an adequate test, so there is no evidence to charge the suspect, and Marvin Brandlin's murder still remains officially unsolved. Lawrence Bittaker and Roy Norris were known as the toolbox killers because they routinely employed implements such as pliers and hammers in their vicious series of kidnaps, rapes, torture, murders of five teenage girls in California in 1979. The last three of these murders, that of a 16-year-old Shirley Ledford, occurred after they spotted Ledford hitchhiking home from a Halloween party. They picked her up in their van, and over the course of hours, they bound and gagged her, smashed her elbow repeatedly with a hammer, and did many other terrible things to her, before finally strangling her to death with a wire coat hanger and then dumping her body in someone's front lawn. During the course of Ledford's murder, they tape recorded themselves, taunting her while she was screaming for mercy. Norris was later quoted as saying, "We've all heard a woman scream in horror films. Still, we know that no one is really screaming. Why? Simply because an actress can't produce the sounds that convince us that something vile and heinous is happening. If you've ever heard that tape, there is just no possible way that you'd not begin crying and trembling. I doubt you could listen to it more than a full 60 seconds of it."